And good morning and welcome to the 10th meeting of the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee. We have apologies this morning from the Deputy Convener, David Torrance. Our first item is to agree to take consideration of items 5 and 6 in private when we'll be considering the evidence that we hear this morning. Our colleagues content that we should do so. We are, thank you. That brings us directly then to the item 2, which is our inquiry into the A9 duelling project. And this morning's evidence session follows on from our evidence session at the last meeting of the committee when we heard from the former First Minister, Alex Salmond. We're joined again this morning by Edward Mountain, MSP, in his capacity as a reporter from the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for this inquiry. And those of this, I see also, again, that we have the petitioner in the gallery this morning, Laura Hansler, so who has been a faithful attendee of the committee when we've been taking evidence and considering the issues raised in this petition. And those who've been following our inquiry will know that our primary objective in all of this has been on ensuring that the A9 is now on track and will be delivered going forward. That is what the petitioners are keen to see. And the petition also calls for a national memorial in respect of all of those whose lives have been lost during the course of the years. And we, at the very end, just asked Mr. Salmond for his views on that, and we'll maybe come to that with our witness this morning later on. So I am absolutely delighted that we have with us this morning Nicola Sturgeon, MSP, the former First Minister. And if you're content, then we'll just move straight into questions. Okay. I mean, we've had a lot of evidence from technical people, from different trades, from people affected by the route, from ministers. You contributed along with others. Alec Neil suggested we go looking for various bits of paperwork. I didn't realise it would be a foot thick when we actually got it. We've been through it all. And I'm not preempting the committee, but I think colleagues are at the stage now, we don't think there's any smoking gun here in relation to the non-completion of the road. But it does seem that at some point, something happened. I don't know if we'll ever be entirely clear what, which led to a dilution of the focus and the drive that was taking the delivery of the project forward. And so when we heard evidence from Mr. Salmond last week, perhaps not unexpectedly, always hale and hearty when he left office. There had been a manifesto commitment from the SNP, which had underpinned this project in terms of its priority, maybe over other national infrastructure projects that might be regarded as equally viable. A lot of the work during Mr. Salmond's time was about preparatory sort of investigation into what would then be required. But there was no suggestion that the road wasn't going to be delivered sort of on budget and on time in the public mind or in the mind of the Parliament in the immediate years after. And so I'm interested just in your perspective as to what happened. Because, I mean, I realise as infrastructure and then subsequently as First Minister, you had different views on what was going on. But we know the road didn't get built, so something didn't happen, and I suppose we're interested as a committee to try and understand what that was and see if there are lessons to be learned from that.
I'll do my best in response to your question and obviously in the course of today's session to answer these questions as fully as I can. I suppose my starting point would be to agree with your starting point. I don't think there is any smoking gun. I don't think there is anything, you know, deeply sinister here that the committee can uncover. I also, and you know, clearly this is from my perspective, I don't agree there was a diminution of the focus and drive behind the A9. You know, during my time as First Minister, the two sections that are now complete of the duelling were completed, and there was and continues to be an incredible amount of work to progress things. Obviously, in the process of preparing for this session, I've had the opportunity, I thought I'd left behind reading government papers when I stood down from government, to go back and read all of the paperwork around this. And I suppose my observations would be, and it's a question in my mind, and it will no doubt be a question in the committee's mind, is, you know, back in 2011, when the 2025 target was set, which was a target we were absolutely committed to in good faith, The question in my mind now is that was there sufficient rigour and openness about just how challenging a target that was? And when I look at it now, you know, that target to have been completed, met, would have required a fair wind on every aspect of the project that we were embarking upon. Of course, we didn't have a fair wind on every aspect of it. We'll come on to some of these issues, no doubt, but the 2014 change of classification around NPD, for example, issues like austerity, Brexit, the pandemic, all had an impact on this. And therefore, I think we simply encountered a situation where the complexities of this, you know, we talk about the A9 being a single project. It's actually 11 major projects in one. A lot of effort went into some of the preparatory stages, public consultation, for example. One of the, and I don't want to sound as if I'm underplaying the challenges here, but I think one of the achievements is, unlike, for example, the Aberdeen bypass, we haven't ended up caught up in endless legal processes through, you know, challenges and public inquiries, for example. So I that is my observation. I think with any project like this, one that has not been delivered on the timescale initially set, at an appropriate time, a look back in this committee's deliberations will be part of that, to see whether there were stages or points where things could have gone quicker than they did would be appropriate. But I think we have progressed the A9 with drive and determination. We just have encountered along the way significant challenges. Some of them foreseeable in a project of this scale, but many of the others that were encountered not foreseeable at the time the 2025 target was set.
And, I mean, you challenged the suggestion that there was any diminution in focus. I say that only because when we read the papers and the timeline, all the way through until about 2018, it seemed that everything was still adhering to an expectation that the road would be delivered as initially forecast. There was no change in the public kind of perception after that date, but reading the paperwork, there then creeps into this a sense of, are there other funding models that might need to be explored, or how would we go about this? And it's not clear from the paperwork whether it was ministers driving that review or whether the review was being suggested to ministers. So Keith Brown, who I think actually had a pretty experienced track record in relation to the delivery of national infrastructure projects, leaves the responsibility at that point and is succeeded, I think, by Michael Matheson at that point. And it's at that stage, reading the paperwork, that we feel slightly confused. We can't point to anything in particular, but it looks as if at that point there is something happening which isn't in the public domain, but which the discussion around which then promotes a delay from that point.
So having very recently reread all of that paperwork, I think that is a fair point to draw. What I don't necessarily agree with is that underneath that there was some sign of, you know, something going wrong. I think it was a reflection of what was under consideration at that point. Now, you know, I think this point has been made to the committee, but it is worth repeating. Under the, you know, the Scottish Public Sector Finance Manual, the consideration of private finance options on projects of this nature is required. So that is something that was necessary. In 2014, the NPD model became effectively unavailable to us because of its reclassification as public, not private. And then there was a period of having to consider a different potential private finance route, should that have been something that the government decided to do. There was no obvious alternative for a period, and it's taken until very recently to settle on the mutual investment model that the current Cabinet Secretary has since announced and spoken about. So I think that period, so from 2018 onwards, simply reflects the nature of the work and the very technical work that was being undertaken at that particular time. Now, another observation I would make, having reread that paperwork, and it, again, it's not a conclusion, it's a question, and I think it's a question the committee is perfectly, would be reasonable to at least ask, is at that point from sort of 2018 certainly for the couple of years after that, should we have been just a bit more open about the work that was going on? Because the search for a viable private finance model was underway, but we hadn't abandoned the prospect of, you know, design build capital funded option as well. And that was the one that was still theoretically, and I used that phrase deliberately, possible in a 2025 timescale. The private one wouldn't have been. So we were still grappling with many of these issues at the point, in good faith, and the work was being done internally. It is a question, and I think a reasonable question, should some of that have been aired a bit more publicly?
Well, let me just explore that, and then I'll move on to colleagues, because, I mean, in your written submission to us, I mean, you obviously drew the distinction between the period when you had a responsibility directly for infrastructure and your wider responsibilities as First Minister, when you had more of an overview of these matters. So I'm just interested to understand the extent to which you as First Minister, not now reading the papers, but at the time, understood that this was potentially percolating into something that might have been a delay, and whether there was any discussion that took place about whether there was a need for perhaps more public candour about what the impact of that was going to be.
So I don't recall us having a discussion at the time about should we be airing more of this publicly, not because we were trying to hide it, but because it was just the work was being done. It wasn't at a point of conclusion, and therefore, you know, we wouldn't have been at the point of, you know, a ministerial statement about the end result of that. I was certainly, you know, as First Minister, you're not, you have an overview of every aspect of government policy, and from time to time you will be much more closely involved in certain aspects. Of course, as we got to the end of 2019, or rather into 2020, I was consumed by something else rather large. But I would have been aware of the work that was underway, certainly aware of the issues, because it wasn't peculiar to transport projects, of course, aware of and concerned about the reclassification of MPD, because that had a potential knock-on effect on inter-capital programme. I was obviously very aware, and this is pertinent to the A9, in terms of that period where we had no clear and obvious funding route for a period because of the NPD issue and because of the, frankly, very, very significant constraints on our capital budget. So these were things that we were grappling with and trying to resolve. Inevitably, that takes you into a period where a lot of the work seems to be kind of, you know, internal to government as we try to find the solutions. What it doesn't, in my view, equate to is a lack of focus and drive. It's just we've got a problem that we're desperately trying to find the solutions to, but the solutions are not easy to find.
Okay. I may come back with other thoughts later, but I'll move to Fergus Ewing.
Yes, thank you, Convener. Good morning to Nicola. Can I ask, first of all, whether a decision was ever taken during your tenure as First Minister to deprioritise investment in dueling the A9 project?
No, not as far as I'm aware. You were in government during, I think, most of that time, Fergus, so you would be aware of any decisions there. We were, as is in the nature of budgetary processes, and you'll remember as well as I do some of the difficult discussions we had around the cabinet table about budgets, you know, we have to balance the competing priorities, and there will be at different times different projects will have, you know, greater immediate priority than others, but it's always about trying to balance and achieve the objectives that we have set.
Sure. I mean, obviously we did as a party promise, I think from 2007 in manifestos and ever since, and then from 2011 the dueling promise had the target date of 2025. We have seen an extract from a November 2018 cabinet paper advising that the use of private finance would mean the 25 completion date could not be met. So I just wonder, how can that be squared with the assertion that it only became clear in 2023 last year that the 2025 deadline would not be met?
I think it can be squared pretty easily, actually, drawing on what I've just said. And I don't know how many of the papers you would have been seeing personally at the time around this, but there was absolutely, we were not at that point at a position where we had decided it was definitely private finance, because we didn't at that point have a clear private finance route, or that it was publicly funded straight capital provision. So at that point, the situation was, had we gone down a private finance route, the 2025 target wouldn't have been capable of being met, but we hadn't closed the door to the design build capital funded option. It was only, I think if memory serves me correctly, at the end of 2022, right, or thereabouts, that it became clear that there was no route to a 2025 target. Now, with any kind of target, obviously, the closer you get to it, there is a diminishing prospect of it being met. But until that point, there was, at least in theory, a route to 2025, and that closed off round about the end of 22-23, and clearly other factors at play around then as well.
I think it's fair to say we've heard evidence from industry that industry as a whole, the kind of civil engineering contracting world, knew from 2018 at the latest that 2025 just wasn't going to be met in practice, because the scale of the work required could not be done in 7 years. So, I mean, the suggestion really is, and, you know, as you pointed out, Nicola, I was in government as well, so I've said on several occasions that if there's any responsibility that we must accept for the failure to dual the A9, I am part of that, although I never had portfolio responsibility and I didn't receive papers on this matter, I think, from 2018. But do you feel now that because this target was such a major promise for so long, both for the SNP and for the Scottish Government, that an apology should be provided to the people of the Highlands? Because, you know, the issue, I think it's fair to say, in my perception at any rate, in my constituency and in the Highlands in general, has been met with considerable dismay and concern, especially in view, of course, of the tragic loss of life we have seen.
So I want to answer this question quite carefully and seriously, because, you know, people will have heard me during my time as First Minister readily apologise for things that I think merit an apology. I also think it's really important not to, you know, reduce the value of that by simply saying these things to get out of a tight spot. I am sorry that we haven't dualled the A9 won't dual the A9 by 2025. And I regret that. And I think people in the Highlands have every right to feel the way they do about that, not just because it's a target that was set and not met, but the nature of the project and the reasons for the commitment to dualling the A9 were so serious in terms of safety. And, you know, obviously the loss of life on the A9 is a matter of deep regret for everybody, then I think those feelings are justified. I think where I want to, you know, be clear, though, is that I do not accept that the failure to meet that target is because we just didn't bother and we weren't trying to meet that target. It was because the 2025 target was set, and it was set for the right reasons, and we were committed to it. I was Deputy First Minister at the time that target was set in a governmental sense, so I'm not trying to escape responsibility. I had then no direct involvement in the A9. But when I look at that now, I would ask myself, were we as candid as we should have been with ourselves as well as with the public about just how challenging it would always have been, even with the fairest of wins, to meet that target? And then my second point, which I've made already, is that a number of things then happened that were not foreseen or even in some cases foreseeable, that meant it was even more difficult to meet that. So what I'm saying here is, you know, and I'll be careful what I say here, I'm not sitting here saying I'm sorry because we messed up, because we just didn't bother trying to do this. I'm sorry that a whole range of circumstances, many beyond our control, meant that we weren't able to deliver on that target. And I absolutely understand the the feelings of people in the Highlands about that. And that's why I think I'm no longer in government, obviously. But that's why I think it's so important now that the project is completed on the revised timescales that have been set.
Well, thank you for that answer. But could I press you on a couple of more points, please? I mean, it does seem to me that some... Well, first of all, an awful lot of preparatory work, design work, prep work, choosing the preferred route, the progress to made orders, the compulsory purchase orders, the ancillary roads orders, that all is very time-consuming, very complex, and you've alluded to that earlier. But do you not feel that, as I do, that some of the 11 sections could and should have moved into procurement much earlier, and that is a failure?
So, I think, I mean, I don't want to just repeat everything I've said. We ran into a period where we didn't have obvious funding procurement routes, and that's where a lot of the work was being done to resolve. But the second point, and perhaps just the more open point, is given the slippage in the timescale, the considerable slippage in the 2025 timescale, I do think that, and obviously it's what this committee is doing, at least in part right now, but for the government at an appropriate point, I do think, you know, for the purpose of learning lessons for future projects of whatever scale, I think it is important to look back. And notwithstanding everything I've said about the very real reasons that we were confronted with that have led to the delays we're talking about here, to look back and say and ask ourselves, or government to ask itself, were there points where different decisions could have accelerated, you know, for example, other sections of the route going into procurement more quickly. Now, saying that is not me sitting here saying that I think the answer to that is yes, but I think it would be reasonable and perhaps unreasonable not to do an exercise that openly asked those questions and learned appropriate lessons.
I mean, just to ask the same question, but in a more specific form, it is clear from the documentation that four of the 11 sections went to made orders. They went to the completion of the land identified to be compulsorily purchased, and all the ancillary roads orders. They went to made orders. Two went in July 21, and another two in October 21. And I genuinely do not understand, and I've obviously raised this in this session of Parliament, but I genuinely don't understand why those sections are not in procurement now, and why they weren't moved swiftly into procurement. And I wonder if that's a question that you can either answer now, or because it's quite a specific question of which you haven't had notice, whether you could go away and let us have an answer. Because, you know, many people say, and I'm not making this assertion, but many people say that the influence of the Green Party as part of the government since 2021 has had a negative effect, because plainly they alone of all the parties represented in Holyrood are opposed to the duelling of the A9, and very strongly opposed. And therefore, there is a very strong feeling, convener, and I've got no evidence for this, so be quite candid, but there's a very strong feeling that their role played a part in that. And I wonder if you could address that point, but also if you're able to now, or if not later, because it's a specific and detailed question, and we can provide you with the names of each of the four sections, but I'm not going to do that now.
Sure.
But, you know, because they went to that really milestone stage of made orders, why weren't they moved into procurement at that time, if we were serious about progressing the project as quickly as possible?
So let me try and answer it as best I can, and perhaps in a general sense. I'm more than happy to go away from this session on any particular point and look at the paperwork and come back with specific answers in writing if that's helpful to the committee. Can I say two things, though, in general? Firstly, it's not the case that, you know, this was down to the Green involvement in government. In fact, well, people can read the Bute House Agreement for themselves. The commitment to the A9 was not affected by the Bute House Agreement. So, you know, somebody who was First Minister during that time, you know, that was not the case. My second point, though, goes into what, you know, sort of with the caveat that I will go and look again to see whether, you know, there are perhaps other issues that I can throw some light on. But we're talking about a period when, you know, our budgets were under significant and growing pressure, revenue and capital budgets. And we were, as a government, and you members of Parliament have, you know, heard the statements that different finance secretaries have made in recent times about the need for savings, the need to reprioritise, and we all know the reasons for this, but the overarching reason will have been the funding challenges that we have been confronted with and the ongoing work to try to find ways of either through direct capital or a private finance model progressing these sections. So that is the in my view, the overarching reason, but as I say, I'm happy to go away and see if there's further comments that might be helpful.
Just a final question on this issue. Why is it that you argue that there is such a pressure on funding when the capital budget is and has been circa 4,000 to 5,000 million a year, and the estimated cost of duelling the A9 is very substantially less than that? So given the scale of the capital budget, you know, surely many people are right to say that the A9 just wasn't the top priority for the Scottish Government, because there was the money. There's 4,000 or 5,000 million a year. Plainly, at least some of the sections which haven't yet been duelled could have been duelled if more priority was attached. And again, Nicola, that is a strongly held view within the Highlands, so that's why I'm putting it to you today to see if you think that that's a fair point, or if it's completely unfair to yourself and your colleagues who were making the decisions at the time.
If it's possible to be both of those things, I know that's probably the classic politician answer, which I'm trying not to give. It's absolutely a fair point for people in the Highlands to look at it and say, well, we're, you know, the A9 should have been prioritised above the other demands on the capital budget. And if I was living in the Highlands, no doubt that is the view I would have. So I am not in any way suggesting that that is somehow an unfair observation or view for Highlanders to hold. I suppose the other part of that, though, is in the way you posed that question to me, and I understand why you're doing it, and you're doing it on behalf of your constituents, so I'm not criticising that in any way, but you've been in government for many years. To say, point to a big budget with a particular project that is relative to the size of the budget relatively small and say, well, why couldn't that have been done, just doesn't fully encapsulate the process of budgeting. So whatever the quantum of the capital budget was, and you know this as well as I do from your time in government, the demands on that budget for most of the time I was in government, if not all of the time, exceeded the quantum of the budget. Now, within that, of course, there is a legitimate question about the relative priority but that different projects get. But the process of budgeting is we try to balance all of these things to progress everything we want to do. And that, you know, will inevitably lead to different projects or supporters of different projects feeling at times that theirs is not getting the priority it needs. But simply to point to the size of the budget and the cost of the A9 and somehow say that, you know, there was no problem with funding our capital programme, I think is not, that's the bit that's not a fair characterisation of how these things work.
I mean, as the convener said, our focus is not really so much trying to carry out a post-mortem. It's it's more prognosis than diagnosis in terms of how can we put this right and how can we put it as right as quickly as possible. And do you think it's fair, as you know, a seasoned, experienced politician, that you would consent to this, that other parts of Scotland have actually done quite well in terms of transport infrastructure projects over devolution, over the 25 years where both of us have been servants in this place. We've seen the Borders Railway, we've seen, as you've said, the Aberdeen Peripheral Road, we've seen massive improvements in the M74 and M8. We've seen the Forth Crossing, magnificent. And, well, Edinburgh chose the trams. Other parts of Scotland have had massive investment, and that's welcome. But would you agree that it's now, if you like, the Highlands' turn?
I'll invite Maurice Golden to come in with a question.
Yes, just as an aside, Edinburgh, well, certain, well, Parliament at the time, against the wishes of the government you and I were both part of, choosing the trams did have an implication on other aspects of the capital programme at that time, but that's an aside. You know, all of these projects you've spoken about were necessary and important projects. As a relatively new driver, I've only recently been driving across some of these projects. I drove the A9 myself for the first time just a couple of weeks ago. So these projects were all important, and I don't think it is, and I don't think this is the point you're making. You know, it's not the case that we inappropriately prioritise, you know, whether the Queensferry crossing or the M74 improvements or the border railway. But I suppose my short answer to your question would be yes. I do think now it should be, as I would argue it has been, albeit that we ran into the difficulties that I've been speaking about, I would certainly hope and expect that the government now prioritises completing the A9. And I think the programme now that has been set out with the timescales will still have challenges along the way. I would be astonished if it didn't. That, to me, looks like a programme that will succeed, and I think it is absolutely essential that it's given the priority to ensure that it does.
Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Ms Durden, you've made clear in answer to Fergus Ewing regarding the Greens' influence on the duelling of the A9, but obviously the backdrop to your tenure in government was some very ambitious climate change targets, including in 2019 the setting of an extremely ambitious interim target. So I wonder if climate change and looking to tackle that in the context of failing to meet a number of emissions targets had any influence over the priority of duelling the A9?
I think that's a really good question, and I think it's an important question when we're considering any roads projects. In respect of the A9, and obviously we could talk about this in a lot more detail, we might do that, but generally, no, I don't think it did. And the reason the A9 was, if I'm using shorthand here, effectively kind of excluded from the Bute House Agreement, the commitment to do that continued, was because of the reasons why the duelling of the A9 is important. It's not about, you know, providing extra road capacity for more cars. It's fundamentally about safety, and therefore it is a roads project that is important to complete. I think more generally, when it comes to road projects in this day and age, the climate cannot be divorced from these considerations, and that is an important part of any deliberation. But in the sense of the A9, I would argue strongly that the reason we're sitting here talking about delays to the duelling of the A9 is not about the Greens being in government or because we downgraded the priority of that for some consideration of climate and emissions targets.
Thanks, that's very helpful. I'm just trying to square the timeline in my own mind, and broadly on the basis of the evidence we've heard, around 2014 seems to be the point in which the plausibility of completing the project, a red flag was raised, and I think you pointed to 2014 in terms of the financing aspect. Probably around 2018 was where there was a significant change in that, but the Scottish Government didn't announce or didn't find out until 2022 that it wouldn't be plausible to complete by 25. I'm struggling to find that explanation as realistic and plausible on the basis of the track record and what had gone before. I wonder if you could perhaps comment on that.
Yeah, I mean, so looking at this now from the perspective I've got, I think some of these questions and that the committee is posing are reasonable. That doesn't mean that, you know, there's anything sinister there. It's about looking back at something and thinking, you know, we were in a position as a government where we were desperately trying to find a path to meet a 2025 target. The prospect and chances of doing that obviously were diminishing with every year, month that passed, but we hadn't given up on that. The 2014 date is significant because of the ONS issue with the classification of NPD, which then meant, not that that was the point we had to consider a private finance option, that was always a requirement, but we had to effectively scrap the one that would have been the option and try to find another one, which took some considerable work and time to do. And then this period around 2018, which I think I said in response to the convener, if I'm looking at this now in hindsight, that's a point where I think it is reasonable to at least pose the question, should we just have been airing a bit more of this publicly? Because we were, I mean, I think originally, if I'm remembering this correctly, the sort of estimate for construction, you know, was about 6 years. So by 2018, you're getting to that point that even if you've got the finance procurement route settled, you're starting to get tight for a 2025 target. So perhaps if I was to go back to relive that period, I don't think I've read anything that would make me think here's something we could have done to have changed things and actually managed to hit that target. But I think I would say we should perhaps just have been airing a lot more of the difficulties we were in at that point, or challenges we were facing at that point, maybe a bit more openly. But that's me applying hindsight.
Thank you. What was the impact of COVID on the project?
I mean, the impact of COVID on the A9 project would have been multifaceted, as it was on every aspect of government priorities outside of what was required to manage COVID. So it would have, you know, it would have been civil service time. It would have been, you know, the sort of wider industry engagement. It would have been everything associated with a big project would have been and was impacted by. Again, I'm using shorthand here, which is probably always a bit dangerous, but effectively, not just here, everywhere outside what we needed to do to deal with COVID, kind of the rest of government sort of shut down to some extent. And that, of course, impacted the A9 project as it did many other things as well.
And obviously from your assessment as First Minister, the impact of COVID, did it have a kind of multiplier effect where it's not just the period in which COVID was occurring, but how quickly did government and all the operations get back on track?
So, I mean, I think that is an excellent observation. I know we're talking here about the A9, but it is one of the things that is both quite difficult conceptually for people to sort of get their heads around, including people in government at the time, but also very, very real across a whole range of issues. When you take the NHS, the period of, you know, the sort of shutdown of elective treatment on the NHS, the multiplier effect of that in terms of what it then takes to recover that position is significant. And I think on everything else, you know, including this project, it takes more time to catch up with these things than the period of the pause for a whole variety of reasons. And it's not that people are sitting and not trying to get back on top of things, it's just that's the way these things work. So I think on a whole range of things, the COVID experience, although that was, you know, 2+ years, in many walks of life, the recovery period on these things will be much longer than the 2 years of COVID itself.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, that's helpful. Just final question. In terms of the project and obviously running behind time, how were you advised of this? Was it regularly discussed at Cabinet, for example, or was it broadly left to the relevant minister and officials?
Again, I'm happy to sort of set this out in more detail. I think my written submission on this covered the period I was Infrastructure Secretary, not First Minister. So not that I'm asking for more requests, but if it would be helpful to set a bit more of this down in writing, I will do so for the committee. But in summary, as First Minister, you have an overview. So the day-to-day responsibility for making sure things are being done as they should be on any project, but on this one, is the relevant Cabinet Secretary. I, you know, as First Minister, would be not copied into everything, but I'd be copied into significant briefings or submissions on things. And, you know, I would ask questions and get more involved at periods where I thought there was a need for that. That's how these things generally work. The A9 featured, I think Fergus just quoted from a cabinet minute a wee while ago, so it would have featured from time to time in cabinet discussions. And, you know, at particular moments, cabinet secretary would have brought things to cabinet. I don't have all the papers in front of me, so I can't sort of say exactly when that would have happened on the A9, but that's what I'm be happy to provide more written information on if appropriate.
Thank you. Thank you, convener.
Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, convener. Good morning. Just to continue what my colleague Maurice Golden just said, during the evidence session, Alex Salmond said that he would have been astounded if a cabinet secretary decided to be slow in the project and not tell him. Did you have a similar working environment during your time as a First Minister?
Similar to, I'm not sure what...
The working relationship with the Cabinet Secretary who is in charge of A9, if he hasn't given you an update or slow on the project.
I think my reputation, and it's for others to decide whether this is accurate or not, would be I was possibly more of a hands-on micromanager than my predecessor.
I mean, given you were the minister during the Queensferry project and that went finished on time, why do you think that A9 has slowed down or it's not been running on time?
I think for the reasons I've spoken about, the 2025 target, again with hindsight, and this is, you know, one of the features of exercises like this, you look at all these things from a different perspective. I think the 2025 target was always, you know, a massive mountain to climb. And to get to the summit of that mountain, you know, by 2025 was going to require everything to go our way. We then had certain things that didn't go our way. The 2014 ONS issue, you know, austerity, and I'm not making a party political point here, austerity putting huge pressure on budgets. COVID, which I've just spoken about, these were things that, over and above the inherent complexities of this project, the, you know, design, route selection, you know, public consultation, environmental assessments. You know, this is a project that runs through a national park, you know, sites of historical significance. So all of these things were the inherent complexities. When you add on some of the unforeseen complexities, that's the reason that we're sitting here. That doesn't make that easy or acceptable from the perspective of the Highlands, but nor does it equate to a situation where the government just didn't bother trying to progress the A9. It was something that we had significant commitment and drive behind, but we encountered very, very significant challenges along the way.
Just a last question, Commissioner. Say, if you're the First Minister now, what different would you have done, or if you go back a year ago, to speed this up?
So this is where I will be candid with the committee. I've looked again, as you would expect me to, in advance of being here, at all of the papers that I would have seen, and including some I didn't, wouldn't have seen it routinely as First Minister at the time. And I think it's important, before I say what I was about to say, not to sit here and say there's nothing we could have done to speed it up, because, you know, I think it is important that there are processes of looking back to really ask those hard questions, because it will undoubtedly be the case there will be points where different decisions might have speeded things up to some extent. Do I think there is anything in the context we were dealing with and came to be dealing with, do I think there is something we could have done that would have meant the 2025 target turned out to be deliverable? My honest answer is no, I don't, because of the nature of the challenges that we were confronted with. So, you know, in terms of if I was First Minister then, is there something that I think I could have done to meet that target? I genuinely don't. If I was First Minister now, which is not a prospect I really like contemplating, I would, I think, be confident with all of the caveats that you always have to put around major infrastructure projects. I'd be confident in the programme and the timeline that has now been set out by the government.
Thank you. Thank you.
You drew an analogy in your last answer to mountains, and I'm not sure if that was simply because you knew that we were now turning to Edward Mountain.
I don't particularly want to think about climbing.
Be careful where you go with that.
I'm very careful what I say there.
Just to start off with, when we questioned Alex Salmond at the last meeting, he gave a very clear description of how the Cabinet worked. And I think, to quote his word, the big discussion of the Cabinet was always the infrastructure plan, and that he would have known if anyone was dragging their feet. And he picked me up for suggesting that Alec Neil could be dragging his feet, said that couldn't be happening, and that a minister would have come to him if there was a problem with the delay. Do you see that's the way your Cabinet worked as well?
Again, I'll be slightly light-hearted here. I sometimes hear descriptions of how Mr. Salmond's Cabinet operated, and I wonder if I was part of the same one.
I'll just leave it there.
Can I answer the question? Where he's absolutely right is that if we think about the period around the financial crash and after that, infrastructure was a central priority of government. Infrastructure is always a priority of government, but in terms of the economic situation we were facing, the drive to try to drive economic activity through infrastructure projects was absolutely a central focus, and Alec was absolutely pushing that. So that is the case. In terms of how my government, I had, as I say, I think my reputation is probably more of a hands-on micromanager than my predecessor was. So yes, I would be involved in issues that needed to be resolved or pushed on, or where there were issues or I thought things weren't moving fast enough and Cabinet Secretaries would come to me, I would go to Cabinet Secretaries. That's the nature on a day-to-day basis of how government works.
Okay, so using the figure that you used this morning, which was interestingly the same figure that I came up with, that it would probably be a six-year project to build it. And with my experience of compulsory purchase orders and how they actually work, they take a minimum, or can take a minimum, of 3 years to get through by the time you've gone through the whole process of issuing notices, getting confirmation of the government, issuing the orders, speaking to the owners, public inquiry, if that's the way it's going to go. That means that it would take 9 years. So effectively, if you were going to be building the A9 by 2025, alarm bells should have been ringing in 2017-18, that process wasn't entirely moving along at the pace it needed to be. Would you agree with that synopsis?
I think where I would take some issue with how you've characterised it is that a lot of the work was ongoing at that point. So, you know, much of the preparatory work, to use that catch-all phrase, was ongoing. So, you know, we're now sitting in a position where I think, with the exception of one of the sections of the route, all of the orders are in place. So it wasn't the case that none of that was progressing. The 6 years, of course, was an estimate that was made way back, I think, about the construction period. The significant issue, not the only issue, but the significant barrier we were grappling with at that point was funding. Funding options in terms of the coming up with a private finance possibility versus the pressure on our capital programme. So you can have everything else in place, you can have, you know, the all of the preparatory work done, but you need to have routes to funding and procurement, and that was the aspect of this that was the significant or most significant challenge.
With respect, the funding is critically important. I accept that fully, but what I've laid out to you is a timescale that a surveyor and people working within the industry would set to deliver the project, which I think from the moment you issue the first order would be approximately 9 years. And that takes us back, and which is why I'm confused that it only came to light in 2023, when it actually probably should have been coming to light back in 2017. So my question is, Mr. Yusuf, who was the Transport Minister in 2017-18, did he come to you and tell you there was a problem? Because if he didn't, then we probably found out where the delay started from.
I think that would be an unfair characterisation of his position. I don't recall a particular occasion where he came to me and said, First Minister, we've got a big problem with the A9. But we were always looking at you know, the progress and the issues we were grappling with. I think it's important not to be overly binary about this. Of course it was the case that by the time you get to 2017-2018, we realised that there are significant hurdles along the way to completion on target. It was only at that late 2022, early 2023 point that it was clear that there was no viable route to 2025, and that was a funding issue. Again, you know, obviously a lot of the work that was necessary to get the sections of the project into construction was being done, had been done, so things were progressing and moving along. So it wasn't a sort of binary thing of here we are one day with none of the work done and we don't have enough years left to do it. It was an ongoing process that we were determined to try to find a route to 2025. It was a diminishing prospect the closer to that you got. Obviously, that stands to reason. And we reached a point where it was clear there was no viable route to that. So I suppose if I was to kind of turn that question back, maybe the criticism that could be made is we were so determined to try to find a route that maybe we didn't tell ourselves quickly enough that that wasn't there. But if that is a valid criticism, it came not from a lack of priority or a lack of determination. It probably came from the opposite of desperately wanting to get to a position where we could deliver the target.
Okay, my final question is that I don't doubt your determination to deliver it, but it was clearly unfeasible by 2017 and 18, even by the figures that you've given. And surely that would have been the time to tell the people across the Highlands that it wasn't going to be delivered. Because, you know, since that date, I think there'd be very few people in the Highlands that haven't seen or know somebody that's been killed as a result of the road, and I think we've been dishonest, or you've been dishonest, by the fact that it's not deliverable by the date that your government promised in 2006 of December 2011.
So I think both the points I would make in response to that I've already made, so forgive me for repeating myself. Firstly, it was not the case that government, you know, the advice to government was still that there was a viable route to 2025 until that point. Well, that was the advice to government, and that was the case. Now, that viable route depended on capital provision being made available, and that was a significant challenge. So that's my first point. So to say that we were just being dishonest, I think is not the case. The second point, though, is when I think I made in my first answer to the convener. Yes, I look back in that period and think we should have been airing this perhaps more publicly. I certainly think that is a reasonable question to pose. But if we were, you know, guilty of something at that point, it was trying our hardest to find the route to 2025 and perhaps taking too long, and this is where I'm happy to concede, we maybe just took too long to accept that it wasn't possible. But if that's the case, it was for the best of reasons. You know, everybody who has or knows someone who has lost someone in the A9, you know, my condolences and heart goes out to every single person in that position. The dualling of the A9 has been a priority for the Scottish Government. It has encountered significant challenges. It was always going to, but some additional challenges. I don't believe it's the case that we're sitting here today because government just didn't give it enough priority. But there is absolutely no doubt that the priority has to be attached to this until that commitment is made. And I am absolutely of the view, going back to the question Fergus asked me, is that the government has an obligation to make sure that the revised timetable is now met and met in full.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
And I think I maybe should say that I'm not sure Mr Youssef was actually the lead minister for the project at any point. I think it was Keith Brown.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then Michael Matheson.
Yeah.
Just looking forward, your predecessor very generously suggested to the committee, as we looked to how the route might be completed in the future, that his advice to this committee, to Parliament and the government, would be to appoint Alec Neil as an A9 czar to oversee the completion of the project. And I just wondered if you'd welcome the opportunity to take a view maybe on the concept of that as much as the nominated individual.
No, I don't think that would add anything to where we are right now. And actually, my concern would be that that would slow things down, somebody coming in and then deciding that they wanted to kind of have a fresh look at everything. I think the government is now in a strong place in terms of where it is with funding, with the reassessment of the order of the routes, the time scale of that. And I think government should now be able to get on with that and held to account in getting on with that. So no, I think that suggestion would hinder rather than help.
As it happens, I met Mr. Neil, who was slightly surprised at the suggestion. Not that, of course, he was disappointed at the...
I will make no comment.
You referred to the Queensferry crossing, and of course, we had an interesting discussion with Mary McCallum before she surrendered responsibility for this particular project to Fiona Hislop, where I pointed out, and although it was driven by a government bill, that I was the convener of the hybrid committee that had taken forward the Queensferry crossing route planning and build design. Joe Fitzpatrick was on that committee as well. Neither of us were invited to the opening, let me tell you, which is a grievance that has rankled with...
Can I tell you there were lots of sensitivities at the opening that I only became aware of afterwards, so it's a sore point.
But more generally, the point was that project, the existence of a sort of parliamentary committee sort of overseeing some of that harder work kind of created its own momentum. Part of the issue with the A9 is it's now been a multi-parliament project. You know, parliamentarians who were first involved in discussions in the chamber around this are long since retired. I mean, I think, you know, we've got 90 new parliamentarians since 2016, effectively. And I wonder whether, as we look forward to a project that now looks as if it could run till 2035, and Mary McCallum, I think, thought there was some merit in looking at this. Is there a way in which Parliament could perhaps be involved with some sort of institutional memory carrying forward over the period up until then, in order that we don't find that somebody else at a later date is having to try and have an inquiry into everything that takes place in relation to the construction of the route from this point forward?
So at risk of being accused of trying to curry favour with the convener of the committee, I think that is an eminently more sensible suggestion than the one you just asked me about. The A9 was always going to be a multi-parliament project. And obviously, and I won't try, you know, the differences, because of the, you know, the legislative requirements around the Queensferry crossing versus the A9, it was a different process. That's why there was a parliamentary committee in one and not the other. But I do think that is something that should be considered. I keep saying we should consider, obviously I'm not in government anymore, but should be considered, and it's for Parliament to consider as well, how there is a sort of built-in parliamentary oversight process with MSPs who effectively become specialists in it. And if it's a multi-parliament project, then as you put it, there is some way of carrying that institutional memory forwards. And I do think that is something that should be given some serious consideration.
Just a quick point on that, Mr. Ewan. Mm-hmm.
Yes, just to ask the to ask Nicola, this references were made to the revised completion date of 2035, and many people, the petitioner who's with us today, and MSPs from all parties but one, are due to meet John Swinney with the aim of urging him to accelerate that date. So, in other words, to complete the project before 2035. And, of course, as you've also said, Nicola, every single section, I think, now has gone to made orders, with the possible exception of Dunkeld. Mm-hmm. And therefore, you know, nothing is stopping the scheduling of the completion of the various sections as quickly as the work can be done. And the contractor's representative has always said that the companies can rise to the occasion and do it more quickly if they're given the contracts and the funding is available. would you agree with me that this is a reasonable objective, and that if it's at all practically possible, that it would be very desirable indeed, in the light of the failure to meet the original 25 deadline, to bring the completion date forward from 2035 so that people can see it in our expected lifespan.
So if it is practically possible, then yes, I would. I've not been in government for more than a year now, so it would not be fair to me, of me rather, to comment on whether I think it is taking all of the different factors into account practically possible. But if it is, then yes, I think acceleration of that timescale should be something government tries to achieve. And, you know, as well as I do, that I think John, you know, he's a MSP on the route of the A9. If that is practically possible to do, then I'm absolutely certain that he would be very open-minded to doing it. But it's important that I don't try to speak for government or the First Minister, given that I'm not at all close to the detail of these things in the way that I once would have been.
And really a final question, and it is relating, as I said at the start, to the other ask of the petition that we've been considering, is whether a memorial to those whose lives have been lost would be appropriate. I think Transport Scotland was slightly concerned that the looked at it rather sort of literally as a memorial, more or less, in the central carriageway of people driving past, which I don't think was the suggestion. Mm. And your predecessor pointed, of course, to the memorial that was built at Queensferry in relation to those people who had died during the construction of the Fourth Rail Bridge many years before. And I wonder whether you think, given the loss of life, I can't remember, certainly Mr. Salmon's time, I know, and probably both of us too have been involved in politics, can remember national tragedies like Lockerbie or Piper Alpha, where there was a considerable loss of life, where there is a memorial that people can go to. What your thoughts, as you would have had as a First Minister, had you received a sort of suggestion of that kind, and if there was merit in it, what you think the process would be that would evaluate that best and potentially take it to any form of conclusion?
So I would be supportive of that proposal. I think it would be appropriate. We tend to have memorials to disastrous tragedies that lead to a significant loss of life in a single incident, which is entirely appropriate. But we perhaps don't do the same with loss of life over longer periods of time in the kind of situation we're speaking about. And I think we should. I guess my views on this have possibly been strengthened even by the COVID experience. I know from my very close involvement in that, with talking to bereaved families, just how important it is to have recognition, to have somewhere that people can go to reflect, to remember, to come to terms with their grief. So I think the importance of that really can't be overstated. So it's a proposal that would have my general support, does have my general support. In terms of the process, again, I draw from the experience of COVID to some extent in this. I think it would be wrong and inappropriate for government to effectively decide what that should be. So the starting point in any process of that should be engagement with those who have lost loved ones, or those who live on the route of the A9, those with, to use the term, lived experience of the loss that we are seeking to commemorate, and work that process from there. Memorials take many different forms. We all, I think, have, as you've alluded to, particular images in our mind when we talk about memorials, but there's lots of COVID memorials that are open spaces, gardens, places where people simply go to reflect. So I think it would be important to properly understand what would be meaningful for those who have lost loved ones on the A9.
Thank you very much for that. And I think that draws our questions to an end. Is there anything we've not touched on that you would like to add?
No, I think we've covered everything I expected us to cover. I think there's been a couple of moments where I have rather rashly offered to provide more written, if the committee could perhaps
remind me
of that, since I no longer have the army of civil servants sitting behind me to remind me later.
Welcome to our world.
Indeed.
There we are. But can I thank you very much for joining us this morning, and actually for the candour in the way in which you've addressed the committee's questions. Very grateful for your time, and I briefly suspend the session in order for us to just rearrange. Thank you. Okay, welcome back. And we now move to item three on the agenda, which is the consideration of continued petitions. The first of those petitions is petition number 1905, a public inquiry into the response of religious organisations to allegations of child sex abuse since 1950. This is lodged by Angela Rosina Cousins on behalf of the UK XJW's support. And we last considered this petition on the 23rd of September, calling on the Scottish Government to order a public inquiry into the allegations taken by religious organisations in response to child sex abuse allegations since 1950. We asked the then Deputy First Minister about work arising from the independent inquiry into child sexual abuse in England and Wales, and about how the implementation of national child protection guidance is monitored in the context of religious settings. We received a response in November of last year, which highlights that child protection committees were asked to return a self-evaluation by the end of October that year. The Scottish Government was then due to work with the Centre for Excellence for Children's Care and Protection to analyse those returns, and a report was due at the start of 2024 to summarise the national implementation progress. The then Deputy First Minister highlighted that under the guidance, faith organisations should have designated child protection leads who have a role in passing on concerns about children to police or social work and in developing and maintaining organisational policies and procedures. Government officials presented to the Faith and Belief Representatives Group in 2022 to raise the profile of the guidance. Now, in response to the report in England and Wales, the Scottish Government has been working with stakeholders to gather views and consider the potential risks and merits of mandatory reporting of child sexual abuse in a Scottish context. The petitioner's submission emphasises the challenges associated with engaging certain religious groups in this work. She states that her experience suggests that not all religious groups will engage with advisory groups or committees. She argues that this is why it is important to legally require religious leaders to report allegations of abuse to the authorities. So, do members have any comments or suggestions as to how we might proceed? And it does seem as if we've been going round the houses here, and the government's view is fairly clear. It seems to me that irrespective of the views that the committee has expressed or has supported, that they are not minded to proceed in this way. Mr. Ewing?
Yeah, yes, I tend to agree, Convener, that I think we've exhausted the avenue, so could I suggest that we close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that the Scottish Government won't widen the Scottish Child Abuses Inquiry's remit to include abuse in different settings, that the Government has taken steps to raise the profile of the National Guidance for Child Protection with religious organisations, and finally that the Scottish Government is monitoring national data to track implementation of the national guidance.
Thank you, Mr. Ewing. Are members of the committee in agreement? Mr. Golden.
I'm a bit cautious about closing the petition, although I do think that we are reaching the end of the road. I wonder if there might be one final opportunity for the committee to write to the Deputy First Minister and ask for detailed information about the work being undertaken to consider the findings and the recommendations of the independent inquiry into child sexual abuse for England and Wales, and for an update on the publication of the implementation progress report and its findings, because I really feel that there was an error in limiting the scope of the inquiry.
Which we have explored,
yes,
with the government. I mean, could we take forward Mr. Ewing's proposal and combine it,
yeah,
and perhaps express the view on behalf of the committee that, you know, we ourselves felt that this was the wrong action that the government has concluded it will take, and that in closing the petition we would very much welcome a final report from them in relation to the question that you've posed. Would that satisfy? Would colleagues be content with that? We will. So it's been a very important petition, one that we've discussed on a number of occasions, sadly without achieving the progress that we would wish, but we will make the view of the committee, which has, I think, been very much one in support of the petitioner, finally to the Scottish Government and seek that additional information in relation to the comparative work in England and Wales. It brings us to petition number 1911, the Review of Human Tissue Scotland Act 2006 as it relates to postmortems. And this has been lodged by Anne Stark, who I think I can see with us in the gallery again. It calls on the Scottish Parliament to... I say I think because I have a big spotlight shining in my face up there and it's difficult to see anybody down at that end of the room from here. So the petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to review the Human Tissue Scotland Act 2006 and the relevant guidance to ensure that all postmortems can only be carried out with permission of the next of kin, do not routinely remove brains, and offer tissues and samples to next of kin as a matter of course. And we're joined again by our colleague Monica Lennon, who has been with us before when we've been considering this petition. Good morning to you and welcome, Monica. We last considered the petition on the 6th of September last year, and at that time we agreed to write to the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, the Royal College of Pathologists and other relevant organisations. The Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service's response to the committee confirms that recent discussions with pathology providers have included the benefits and possible difficulties with the suggestion of the use of CT scanners as an alternative to invasive post-mortem examinations. The response also highlights the HM Inspectorate of Prosecution in Scotland's annual report 22-23. The inspector's view is that consideration of the delivery model for forensic pathology is required. The report notes the cross-sector nature of work in this area and therefore suggests that the Scottish Government should lead. Both the Royal College of Radiologists and the Royal College of Pathologists have highlighted the existing clinical guidelines relating to the use of CT scans and post-mortem examinations. The Royal College of Radiologists states that there should be, in principle, no reason that CT scans could not be used during post-mortem examinations in Scotland. And at the time of writing, the guidance, the availability of expertise and imaging interpretation was limited to a small number of centres in the UK. The Royal College of Pathologists notes that many types of deaths which can be diagnosed by post-mortem imaging in England would not require an autopsy of any kind in Scotland. The submission suggests that the impact of scanning and the overall autopsy rate in Scotland is likely to be much less than in England. The petitioner has provided two written submissions which reiterate the key ask of her petition, and she also notes that a meeting recently took place between herself and the Lord Advocate, I think Monica Lennon may have been at that meeting too, where they discussed her individual case and the changes the petitioner wishes to see. Now, the committee has uncovered a number of issues throughout its consideration of this petition to date, and we've gathered a lot of written evidence from a number of key organisations, and we've taken oral evidence to inform our thinking of the issues, all of which I think have had us as passengers in support of the aims of the petition as it's progressing this issue. Before I invite members of the committee to see where we might go next with it, I wonder if Monica would like to give a brief statement.
Good morning, convener, and thank you for that. And just listening to you there give a bit of a recap, I think it does show we've been on quite a journey. So again, I pay tribute to Anne Stark and her husband, Jerry, but also to the committee, because at the start of this process, we knew very little in terms of, you know, the Parliament's understanding of what was going on, the government not really taking an active interest, and I think fair to say the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service thinking there was nothing to see. Convener, you mentioned a meeting on the 17th of April, with the Lord Advocate and Andy Shanks, who's the head of the Scottish Fatalities Investigation Unit. Anne and Jerry Stark were there along with myself, and I think we met for almost 2.5 hours. And the Lord Advocate was very much in listening mode, but she had lots of questions. And I think it speaks to the fact that since Richard Stark's death in 2019, the family are still trying to get answers. And it shows how difficult it can be for grieving families to deal with the system. So this has always been about improving the system, not just for the Stark family, but all the other families in Scotland. So again, a big thank you to the committee, because we've now got a lot of evidence and information available to us. And we know that we need to learn lessons, but we also need to learn from other places, other jurisdictions, where families have been listened to, modernisation has been started, if not rolled out, and lessons have been learned, and that's included making efficiencies and savings at a time when public finance is under pressure, but also leading to a more compassionate experience for families. So today, again, just to emphasise on behalf of Anne and Jerry Stark, this is about trying to minimise distress to grieving families, you know, at the worst time in their lives. As Anne has said in her written submissions, Richard's death was not suspicious, but the family feel that they were treated exactly the same way as what would happen in a murder case or a highly suspicious death, and that made their ordeal all the harder to bear. If I just touch on the Lord Advocate discussions that we had, because I think I characterised the session when she came to the committee as being tense, because it was quite difficult to try and tease out, you know, who was going to take responsibility for making change happen. The Lord Advocate has written to us since the meeting, making clear that she shares the family's desire to make whatever improvements they possibly can, they being the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service. Lord Advocate reiterated the apology for poor communication on behalf of the service and recognised that that caused unnecessary distress. There was some discussion about the family liaison charter, which should include looking at the medical history of the deceased, and that then informs whether a full invasive post-mortem is required. So we recognise, not just for the Stark family, but for many families, there is a communication issue, and that's something that they are looking at. So we know the Crown Office, Procurator Fiscal Service, is committed to the continuous improvement of their death investigation work. I think it's probably fair to say, because of this petition, because of this committee's work, the Death Investigation Improvement Programme has been established, and the purpose is to oversee a programme of work designed to achieve greater public confidence, and I think that's really important, greater public confidence, improve the service delivered to bereaved relatives, and deliver increased efficiencies in the investigation of deaths. On the issue of samples, which I know is in your papers today, again, just want to reiterate that Richard Stark died in 2019, and as we sit here today, on the 29th of May 2024, his parents and wider family still await confirmation that all samples of Richard are accounted for. The Lord Advocate, in her letter to me, has confirmed that she's making further inquiries with pathology providers who are contracted to do this work. So again, it shows how difficult this can be. In terms of the CT scanning, as you've been told, COPFS regularly meets with the current pathology providers, and the potential future use of CT scanners has, from time to time, formed part of their discussions. It's our view, in my view, speaking to the family, that, you know, this has not been, in terms of the conversations, it's not really led to anything up until now, and it's been mentioned almost in a sort of ad hoc way. But more positively, since the Lord Advocate last appeared at the committee, members of the Crown Office, Procurator Fiscal Service, Pathology, Toxicology and Mortuary Programme Board visited Northern Ireland. They received a presentation, we're told it was informative, a presentation from the state pathologist on the experience in Northern Ireland of utilising CT scanning. So we welcome that, we do welcome that. Mrs. Stark and the family suggested to the Lord Advocate that perhaps the Crown Office, Procurator Fiscal Service, or that board that I just mentioned, visit Lancashire, where we believe Dr. James Adley would be happy to facilitate such a visit and a sort of fact-finding trip. And today, my suggestion to the committee is that the committee may wish to consider the opportunity for such a site visit. I know from time to time the committee does get out of Parliament, If it's something that has been actively considered by the Lord Advocate and her colleagues, it would be worth checking in to find out where they've got to on that. I won't repeat points that have been made previously about the resourcing issues and the workforce pressures facing the Crown Office, Procurator Fiscal Service, and more generally pathology and other health services who are involved. You know, it's very much a case of we need to have the right people doing the right jobs. And I think we've identified that there are shortcomings in the skill set within the Crown Office Procurator Fiscal Service. I think that's why a submission that was made by Dr. Adley, which I have in front of me, it's actually a few years old now, but it was a paper submitted to the UK Justice Committee back in September of 2020. And again, it talks a lot about the importance of communication and the relationship with families. So we want to minimise the stress. We want to try and deal with workforce pressures. We want to use public resources better. We've heard about potential savings and at least achieving cost neutral through the work in Lancashire. So in conclusion today, I just wanted to, again, thank the committee because we can see that the work here is actually making a difference. We've still got quite a distance to go. What I'm not so confident of right now is how engaged the Scottish Government is and how meaningful that is. So I think the visit would be important, and really the opportunity here is to minimise the stress to grieving families, to modernise the investigation of unexpected and sudden deaths, and to build resilience into the system. The scanners give us another tool that we don't currently have. In terms of the Human Tissue Act, I think it does need reform. I'm only giving one example today in terms of the situation with the Starks. But as you know from Anne's submissions, there's many other families who have found themselves in this situation. So again, thank you for the committee's compassion towards the Stark family, but really we want every family to experience the same level of compassion and to know that the system is going to modernise. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you very much for that, Monica Lennon. Yes, I think it is the case that we have now assembled a very considerable amount of evidence, and I think the committee, having had a chance to discuss these matters privately as well, is of the view that we now need to write to the Scottish Government quite directly highlighting some of the matters that we've raised. I wonder, for the record, if one of my colleagues might like to summarise what we would like that letter, we're proposing that letter, would the areas that it would cover. Mr. Ewing?
Indeed, there's quite a lot of ground here. I'll just read from the text.
I think, yeah, because it's quite a comprehensive series of asks.
And just to say I'm very grateful for Monica Lennon's work, which is a credit to herself in taking this matter up so diligently. So I think we should write to the Scottish Government to highlight the inspector's view that consideration of the delivery model for forensic pathology is required, and the Scottish Government should lead this work. Just in passing, if I could just say that, you know, it was evident that the Crown Office, the Lord Advocate, and their evidence really passed the buck in the saying, and this is really primarily a matter of medical evidence. So they themselves were, if you like, not taking the lead. Mm-hmm. So I think the Scottish Government really should take the lead in that regard. Mm-hmm. Secondly, the Scottish Government should highlight the issues and suggested improvements to pathology services raised during the committee's consideration of the petition, including that the lack of clear direction and fragmented nature of the service leads to challenges in resolving issues as they arise, that there is inconsistent and unclear communication with the next of kin, offering the return of tissue samples to the next of kin, and the use of CT scanners as an alternative to invasive postmortems. And I think we have, thanks to the petitioners and Monica Lennon and the committee's work, had a lot of evidence about each of these things. So I don't think there's any point in rehearsing all of that. We also want to write to the Scottish Government to highlight concerns in forensic pathology services about value for money affordability, sustainability and contractual terms, as noted in the Inspectorate's annual report, to highlight the Crown Office and Fiscal's call for a national forensic pathology service, and recommend that the Scottish Government brings together service providers, the Crown Office and stakeholders to consider the key challenges facing pathology services as identified in the petition and the Inspectorate's report, takes ownership of and leads the development of a delivery model for pathology services, and finally ensures that any delivery model facilitates continuous and long-term improvement of pathology services. I've just said in conclusion, that's all a little bit dry. I mean, it's sort of parliamentary MSP speak, but at the heart of this is the concern that the next of kin's wishes should be really respected and taken into account, and that they should be treated with dignity and respect in the desperately difficult situation that they face.
So thank you, Mr. Ewing. And I think that this obviously draws on a lot of what we have heard as members of the committee. And in the first instance, I think we would set this out now to the government in the terms Mr. Ewing has suggested and see what response we get from the Scottish Government at that point, which would then inform how we might then take matters forward after that. Are members of the committee in agreement with the work that we're proposing? Then thank you all very much, and we will keep the petition open and act on that basis. And thank you again
thank
to you.
You
and to the petitioners for the work that has been done. Petition number 1984 to introduce the C100 form for child arrangement orders in Scotland, lodged by Amy Stevenson, calling on the Parliament to urge the Government to reduce the financial barriers that prevent parents from having contact with their children by introducing a Scottish equivalent to the C100 form with a fixed fee for making applications for child residence or child contact orders. Now, we last considered this at our meeting on the 4th of October 23. We've received a response from the Minister for Victims and Community Safety suggesting that while work is underway to implement Section 24 of the Scotland Act, Children's Scotland Act 2020, it is likely to be later in 2024 before the Government is in a position to advance with the pilot scheme on mandatory alternative dispute resolution meetings. The Minister's response also notes that the Scottish Government does not plan to review the current system for initiating actions for child contact and residence orders due to, and I quote, other priorities and pressures, but does refer to actions in the Family Justice Modernisation Strategy that could help improve the experiences of individuals going through child contact and residence disputes. Do members have any comments or suggestions? Mr. Golden.
Thank you, Convener. I think we should close the petition under Rule 5.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that, firstly, Section 24 of the Children's Scotland Act 2020 requires Scottish ministers to arrange a pilot scheme for mandatory alternative dispute resolution meetings, with work underway for the pilot to commence this year. Secondly, the Scottish Government have no plans to review the current system for initiating actions for child contact and residence orders. I think it might be helpful in closing the petition to flag to the petitioner that they have the option of resubmitting the petition in 12 months' time, should no progress have been made on the pilot.
Yep, thank you very much for that, Mr. Golden. Are members of the committee content to proceed on that basis? We thank the petitioner very much for raising the issue with us. In light of the response, I think the committee feels there's no immediate further course of action for us, as Mr. Golden has summarised, but I emphasise the point made that it is perfectly possible if the aims or commitments of the government have not been achieved or realised in 12 months' time for the petition perhaps to be brought back to us at that time. That brings us to petition number 2024 to create a national public information programme to raise awareness of the impacts of steroids, selective androgen receptor modulators and other performance-enhancing drugs. This has been lodged by Cale Scott. It calls on the Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to create a national public information programme to raise awareness of these products. And it should have a particular focus on the impact of young people aged 16 to 25, working with community learning and development practitioners, gyms and community coaches to raise awareness, And finally, to develop a public health campaign to highlight the negative impacts of PEDs, encourage regular health checkups for users and a screening programme allowing users to test the safety of their PEDs. And we last considered this on the 6th of September 2023, when we at that time agreed to write to the UK Anti-Doping, Anabolic Steroids UK and the Scottish Drugs Forum, as well as the Scottish Government. And the Scottish Government responded to provide the terms of reference of the Early Interventions for Children and Young People Working Group, which notes that it will be guided every step of the way by experiences of young people whose lives have been affected by alcohol and drug use and the frontline services who support them. The response also lists the organisations who are members of the working group. The UK Anti-Doping response draws our attention to their 2019 report, which was on image and performance-enhancing drugs, which showed that use of imaging and performance-enhancing drugs, IPEDs, extends beyond cheating in sport and is a significant public health issue. It is UK Anti-Doping's view that structural arrangements to establish cross-agency working is needed to tackle wider public health concerns relating to IPED use. The Scottish Drugs Forum would welcome and actively support any harm reduction focused national initiative on the risks and harms associated with IPED. The Scottish Drugs Forum suggests that a national campaign should be accompanied by a provision of adequate services such as blood testing and other health checks to reduce harms. And we have also received a response from the petitioner, sharing their analysis of a freedom of information request on the costs, prevalence and existing support for IPED use in regional health boards across Scotland. Do members have any comments or suggestions for action, given the quite robust responses we have received? Mr. Goldham.
Thank you, Convener. I do think we might be nearing the end of the road on this one as well. However, I think we could write to the Minister for Drugs and Alcohol Policy to highlight the written evidence the committee has received, as you've articulated, and seek an update on what specific action the Early Intervention Working Group is taking to address public health concerns about the use of image and performance-enhancing drugs, including how it intends to include owners of leisure centres, gyms and fitness professionals in this work.
And I think we might accompany that just with a note on the strength of expression that we received from the Scottish Drugs Forum and from the UK Anti-Doping response to emphasise that. Our colleagues content? We are. Brings us to Petition 2027, the launch the Changing Places Toilet Fund. And this has been lodged by Sarah Heward on behalf of the Tyndrum Infrastructure Group. And it calls on the Parliament to encourage the Scottish Government to launch the £10 million Changing Places Toilet Fund that was pledged in the 2021 SNP manifesto without further delay, and to make the application process clear, straightforward and expeditious for groups trying to build these much-needed facilities. And again, we last considered this on the 6th of September 2023, when we agreed to write to the Minister for Social Care, Mental Wellbeing and Sport. The Minister for Social Care, Wellbeing and Sport's response to the committee highlights the Scottish Government's ongoing commitment to making the £10 million fund available across financial years 24-25 and 25-26. The fund is due, therefore, to open at the beginning of 2025. And in the light of the fact that the aim of the petition has therefore been realised, which is to make the funding available without delay, and that a timetable has been set for that in the early 2025, I'm inclined to propose that we close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis the Scottish Government is working now to make the £10 million available for Changing Places toilets in this parliamentary session. I think that's key. And in closing the petition, the committee could highlight to the petitioner that the fund will open now in 2025, and that if they are not, again, if they are not content with how the government's work progresses thereafter, we would be very pleased to receive a fresh petition at a later date in order to advance the aims. But we have a firm commitment from the government, so on that basis, are members content to close the petition? Mr. Chowdhury, can I just get confirmation from you as well?
Yes. Yes.
Just because Mr. Ewing's left us, and we need three heads to nod. We have that. That's, thank you very much. Our next petition is petition number 2031, to provide insulin pumps to all children with type 1 diabetes in Scotland. lodged by Maria Aitken on behalf of the Caithness Health Action Team, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to ensure that children and young people in Scotland who have type 1 diabetes and would benefit from a life-saving insulin pump are provided with one, no matter where they live. And I'm reminded that I think this was a key issue in the very first Parliament, which I was elected in 2007-11. So it's always intriguing to see how, well, I think insulin pumps had just come on the scene at that point, and we were very keen to have them made available through the NHS. And I welcome, again, Edward Mountain, who has remained with us since our earlier A9 inquiry, who has an interest in this petition, and I'll invite Edward to say a few words in a moment. We last considered this petition on the 20th of September, 23, and at that time agreed to write to Diabetes Scotland, the Insulin Pump Awareness Group, and the NHS Regional Health Boards. And the committees received responses from 8 of the 14 health boards, copies of which were included in our meeting papers. And a number of the responses make reference to utilising additional Scottish Government funding to increase the number of children and young people accessing insulin pump therapy, and the need for further Scottish Government funding to support ongoing staffing and resource requirements necessary to meet now the demand for insulin pump therapy. Because I think it's also the case that since that Parliament in 2007-11, the incidence of diabetes has continued to dramatically increase within the population. We've also received a response from Diabetes Scotland, which highlights the benefits of diabetes tech for people with type 1 diabetes, and this includes improvement of blood sugar management and reduced risk of complications such as stroke, eye damage and kidney disease. The response also draws our attention to the Diabetes Tech Can't Wait report, which they published in November last, which included a number of recommendations to the Scottish Government and to health boards to support the faster rollout of diabetes tech, with an aim of ensuring that 100% of children and 70% of adults living with type 1 diabetes were able to use hybrid closed-loop tech by 2030. And before I invite the committee just to share thoughts on how we might proceed, I invite Edward Mountain to comment.
Thank you very much, Convener. Can I just say at the outset that the Caithness Health Action Team strive hard to ensure that healthcare is delivered across the Highlands, but particularly in Caithness, where it's more difficult to get to Raigmore and the centralised health service that is currently being run by NHS Ireland. There is no doubt up there that there is a feeling of being isolated from that healthcare, which can take at least an hour and a half under blue light to get to, and under normal driving conditions, probably 2.5 hours to get to. So I also remind the committee that in 2023, extra money was given by the Scottish Government, and NHS Highland chose to make sure that, well, to use that extra money for closed-loop therapy being given to mainly to adult and some paediatric services. But there was a concentration on adults that got this. Consequently, some children have missed out. And as the petitioner has made clear, there are approximately 25 children across the Highlands waiting for a diabetic insulin pump. And my estimation of the cost for that, just for the pumps alone, is about £75,000, not a huge amount of money, although there are some ancillary costs involved with running that, as the convener you've made clear, not only in the equipment, but also in the staff. But it would make a huge, huge difference to children as they come to terms, sometimes not understanding fully the effects of the diabetes that they have to face. So it would not require much additional money to make sure that all of the children in the Highlands have insulin pumps. In fact, less than the cost of some of the administrative directors that sit within NHS Highland. And therefore, I think the committee might try and encourage NHS Highland to explain where the funding went originally, the extra money that was given to the government, and why children weren't given a priority, and whether there are additional funds, a mere £75,000, to provide pumps for all the children. But I leave it to the committee. I would just end up by saying that it is difficult to underestimate how remote sometimes the Highlands feel to healthcare, which is centralised. So actually giving them the ability to manage their own treatment would be truly revolutionary. Thank you very much, Camilla.
Thank you, Mr. Mountain. I mean, are our colleagues content to embrace Mr. Mountain's suggestion? And I wonder if there are any other suggestions the committee would like to add in addition? Oh, we've got not a member of the committee, but I'm delighted to see that we've got Claire Hawkey, who is with us this morning. And I'm very happy just to invite you to comment in any way.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for your indulgence and letting me speak on this. I wasn't intending to, but can I just draw committee's attention to a GIQ that was answered yesterday, S6W27895, of which I have constituency interest, which may answer some of Mr. Mountain's asks. I'm happy to elaborate, if that helps. The Minister Jenny Minto confirmed that in this financial year, £8.8 million of funding will be made available to expand access to diabetes technologies in Scotland, and that the focus will primarily be on providing access to all children that want closed-loop systems, and this will also allow them to increase access to adults. So perhaps that might assist.
Well, I think that's... I shan't wander around the room asking for party contributions, but can I thank Claire Hawkey for advising the committee of that? We'll obviously seek just to have confirmation from the government, because that seems quite directly to add to our consideration of the issues raised in the petition. And I suppose we could prompt that by writing to the Scottish Government in response to the Diabetes Scotland Diabetes Tech Can't Wait report, just asking what specific funding that would support the statement that was made by the Minister. Are colleagues content? And thank you very much again, Claire Hawkey, for drawing that to our attention. Mr. Chowdhury.
Yes, sorry. Can you also add, perhaps you could ask the Scottish Government if funding will be adequate, sustainable and recurring, as I understand that NHS Lothian Health Board are currently having to restrict access to insulin pumps and hybrid closed loops technology for adults.
So I think we can certainly ask just the government to confirm the sustainability going forward as well of any funding that they're making available.
And how much each health board will be receiving specifically for the insulin pumps?
Thank you. Anything else? Just don't want to make a dripping roast of saying yes and then having another thing sprung on me. Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. Are members content to incorporate those suggestions into the response, the representation we make? Thank you very much. Petition number 2034, to stop the current proposals for highly protected marine areas, HPMAs in Scotland, lodged by Stuart Churnside, and it calls on the Scottish Government to halt their proposals for highly protected marine areas and bring forward new proposals that take account of sustainable fishing methods. And we last considered this petition in October last year, when we agreed to write to the Scottish Government seeking an update on its alternative plans to enhance the protection of the marine environment. And we've received that response from the Scottish Government confirming that there are no plans to progress the HPMA proposals, nor is the Government looking to designate 10% of Scotland's seas as highly protected marine areas by 2026. So In response to what the petitioner might feel is the validation of their submission, do colleagues have any suggestions for action? And I see Mr. Ewing flailing around in his seat as he seeks to contribute to our deliberation of the issue. Mr. Ewing.
Yes, I'm just going to add, convener, that it's been brought to my attention by fishing representatives that whereas, of course, the HPMA's policy as such was dropped after various representations of various types were made to urge them so to do. In fact, I understand that it's a widely held belief in fishing circles that Nature Scot is busily working on this topic to pursue what some feel maybe HPMAs by another name. And I, therefore, and I haven't seen the factual basis for that, but I wonder if we might, just to for belt and braces, write to Nature Scot to ask if, in fact, they are doing work in this area. If so, what it is, who has asked them to do it, and what role and what input fishing representatives such as those representing fishermen in Clyde and vicinity may be having, if any, in Nature Scots deliberations?
I understand the substance of the question. I'm not sure it's consistent with the petition that we have before us, though, which is quite specifically a petition in relation to the Scottish Government. And I wonder, I mean, I'm not sure that actually that it's competent within the reach of the petition itself.
Whether
it would have to be the subject of a fresh petition. But I'm willing to just take a view from colleagues about that. Mr. Golden?
I mean, I think the terms of the petition around current proposals. Now, while on the face of it, these have been notionally shelved, if the Scottish Government at the time was saying that it wouldn't progress the current proposals, clearly the petition would have to close. However, if they, at that time, instructed Nature Scott to progress some form of the current proposals, then I think it would fall within the scope of the petition, and it might be worth clarifying that aspect with Nature Scott. Clearly, if Nature Scott are doing this off their own bat, or if they are doing it at all, that's a different matter. But I think if the Scottish Government have instructed them, then we should see the details, because I think that might fall in the scope of the petition.
I was going to make exactly the same point that Mr. Golden just made, actually.
I'm outflanked by this, what I would call, rather tenuous link that committee members have managed to draw together by a thread. Fair enough. It will be some time before we consider the petition again. I'm not sure that there might have been not been quicker routes to try and establish all of this, but I mean, is that the will of colleagues? It appears to be, Mr. Chowdhury. Thank you. Well, then we will keep the petition open and we will seek to clarify that point. Thank you. That brings us to agenda item 4, consideration of new petitions. And as I always do, before we consider a new petition, to those who might be joining us, either here or online, to hear their petition discussed, we do in advance of the first consideration ask the Scottish Parliament's independent research body, SPICE, to comment on the issues raised by the petition. And we also write to the Scottish Government for an initial view. And we do that because historically those were the first two things we agreed to do if we heard the petition without having done them first. And so it makes sense for a meaningful advance of the issues of the petition to do that initial inquiry. And the first of those new petitions today is petition number 2082 to improve the support provided to families affected by cot death. And it's been lodged by Kevin McKeever, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to stop promoting the Lullaby Trust to Scottish families for the cot death support, as this charity only provides support to families who live in England and Wales, and provide the practical support available to families by prioritising the promotion of the Scottish Cot Death Trust, who have been supporting families since 1985. Mr. McKeever tells us that he is a parent who lost a child to cot death, also known as sudden unexpected death in infancy, and has previously received support from the Scottish Cot Death Trust. Mr. McKeever is concerned that since having another child, the literature provided by the Scottish Government promotes the Lullaby Trust, who are an English-based charity that do not support families living in Scotland. In responding to the petition, the Scottish Government note that while they have worked in partnership with the Lullaby Trust and other organisations to develop and deliver safer sleep for baby resources, the Government does not promote the Lullaby Trust as a baby loss support organisation. They state that the Scottish Cot Death Trust were invited to become involved in the development of these resources, but declined to do so. The response goes on to detail work to support families who have experienced pregnancy and baby loss, including through the National Bereavement Care Pathways. It's also noted that the Scottish Government has provided funding to the Scottish Cot Death Trust to deliver their sudden unexpected death and infancy simulation and awareness training. I'm minded, I think, to try and establish with the Scottish Cot Death Trust, who are funded by the Scottish Government, why they declined to participate in the drafting of the resources which the government is seeking to make available, because that seems kind of a curious lack of engagement in some respects. I mean, I understand that the principal point the Scottish Government makes in relation to the petitioner's point about promotion of the Lullaby Trust, in which they say that's not the case, and it is the Scottish Cot Death Trust. But I think it's curious that they declined to participate. So I think, would we be content to keep the petition open and inquire on that point? We would. Thank you. That brings us to petition number 2086, to recognise the vaccine injured and offer appropriate treatment. And this has been lodged by William Queen. And it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to acknowledge those injured by COVID-19 vaccines and to have the NHS offer appropriate treatment to those who are injured. Now, the Spice briefing explains that when presented to a GP, treatment isn't necessarily based on or connected to the cause of the illness, but on the alleviating the symptoms and, if possible, treating the underlying cause if this can be identified. It notes that injury caused by the COVID-19 vaccine is still a live area of research and that it is very difficult to find comprehensive and reliable evidence and research that details and defines COVID-19 vaccine injury. But it's an issue I know of with which I have constituents who are also concerned. The Scottish Government's response to the petition acknowledges that on rare occasions, COVID-19 vaccines can cause injury and that concerns over the safety of vaccines are not taken lightly by the Scottish Government. The Government's submission states that recipients of the vaccines are given as much information on the potential side effects as possible and that recipients must give informed consent before receiving a vaccination. The petitioner has provided two written submissions, the first of which calls for the vaccine injured to be given time at a platform to speak about their experiences and asks for the Scottish Government to meet with the vaccine injured group. And the second submission calls for more research into symptoms and illnesses resulting from vaccination, improving diagnosis and treatment for the mast cell activation syndrome, specialist clinics or multidisciplinary teams and financial support for private medical care where adequate treatment cannot be provided on the NHS. So, in the light of the responses we've received, I wonder if colleagues have any clear idea about how we might proceed. Mr. Ewing.
I do think we should write to the Scottish Government, convener, to ask how it can be confident that first specialist diagnostic testing and specialist treatment as set out by the petitioner is available when required, and second, that healthcare providers are aware of the possible side effects of COVID-19 vaccines and apply this knowledge when considering treatment for symptoms which may have arisen as a result of this vaccination. You know, perhaps just add by way of comment that recently I did read in one of the more serious newspapers of some doubts about, I won't go into the details, I don't think it's appropriate, of one of the COVID vaccines that were raised by, I believe, a reputable organisation. So I just wanted to mention that because, you know, it is the subject of current controversy. So I do think that we need to drill down a little bit more and write to the Scottish Government to raise these concerns.
Thank you, Mr. Ewing. And I did hesitate slightly during my comments because I was struck, I'll repeat it, because the government submission states that recipients of the vaccines are given as much information on the potential side effects as possible and the recipients must give informed consent before receiving a vaccination. Because that's exactly the phrase that was used, I recall, in relation to the use of mesh in hospital, in surgical procedures. I remember vividly being told that recipients were being given as much information as possible and were giving informed consent. And the evidence of many of the women in that example was that simply wasn't the case. So I would quite like to ask the government how it is able to assert that practice is in place. And it may be that they can, but I would like to understand how they are able to assert that with confidence, because, and I'm quite happy to say, because the committee obviously can consider previous examples where a similar assurance was initially made but was not seen to funnel in, to be properly validated by the evidence that subsequently emerged. Are there any other suggestions? So, an important petition, I think, given everything that we're now looking at, with the benefit of hindsight, admittedly, but obviously on an ongoing basis in some instances as well. And we'll keep the petition open and proceed with inquiries based on the suggestions that committee members have made. Are we content? We are. Thank you very much. And I'm not sure if we have members of the petition in the gallery with us today, so I hope you're content that we're keeping the petition open and proceeding on that basis. Petition number 2087, to pass a law making exercising a dog in a cemetery an offence. Those in the gallery will see we move very broadly across the range of public interest. And this petition has been lodged by Paul Irvin, and it calls on the Scottish Government to pass a law making exercising a dog in a cemetery an offence punishable by an on-the-spot fine for infringement. Mr. Irvin tells us that he lives opposite... I'm terribly sorry, because Claire Hockey had joined us for that previous petition, but you're quite content with the action we took. Apologies, I did mean to... just occurred to me suddenly there. Sorry, so back to Mr. Irvin, who tells us that he lives opposite the cemetery where his son is buried and has been upset by the number of people who exercise their dogs in the cemetery and allow them to urinate and defecate on graves, including his son's. Mr. Irvin has raised this issue with his local authority, who have introduced a rule that dogs must be kept on leads in cemeteries, but stopped short of their pre-pandemic rule of only permitting assistance dogs in cemeteries. Responding to the petition, the Scottish Government states that it fully recognises the distress, as I'm sure the committee will too, caused by irresponsible dog owners who cause damage to headstones and mementos left at gravesites. However, responsibility for the management, security and upkeep of local authority burial grounds lies with local authority in which the cemetery is located. Existing legislation gives local authorities the power to make, consult on, publish and display management rules that regulate the use and conduct of people while on land or premises owned or managed by the local authority. Additionally, the Dog Fouling Scotland Act 2003 covers all public open spaces. With anyone who does not immediately clean up fouling by a dog, they are committing an offence and could be issued with a fixed penalty notice of £80. The Spice briefing also highlights the Control of Dogs Scotland Act 2010, which allows the police to issue a dog control notice if a dog is not being kept under control effectively and consistently. In the light of that, I wonder if colleagues have got any suggestions as to how we might proceed. Mr. Ewing.
Yes, I have noted the tragic loss of his three-year-old son by the petitioner. I just thought I'd mention that because he lives opposite where his son is buried. So and talks about the family witnessing up to 100 people exercising their dogs daily, with dogs being let off leads or in long leads, resulting in them urinating and defecating in graves and damaging teddies left and so on in memory. So I just thought I'd mention that because, you know, plainly it's a somewhat unusual petition, but there is behind it a human tragedy.
Yes.
So one understands that. For that reason, could I make a series of suggestions that we write to COSLA, given this seems to be primarily a local government responsibility, to seek further detail and best practice for local authorities regarding the presence and behaviour of dogs in cemeteries, to write to Police Scotland to request information on the breakdown of offences under the Dog Fouling Scotland Act 2003 and the Control of Dogs Scotland Act 2010, specifically those that have taken place in cemeteries, in order to ascertain whether there is any pattern of enforcement by the police in this matter, and also to write to the Scottish Government seeking an update on the implementation of the Burial and Cremation Scotland Act 2016, specifically whether proposed regulations for the management of burial grounds might address the issues raised by this petition.
Thank you, Mr. Ewing. Are colleagues content to proceed on that basis? And they are, and that was the last of our new petitions to consider this morning. So we will now be moving into private session to consider items 5 and 6, and our next meeting will take place on the 12th of June.